now watching the Royal Way here on Stadium Drive Sports.
Welcome, Royals Empire, to the Royal Way, the place to be for Royals fans. I'm your host, Sean, here to bring you Royals and around the league updates. In this episode, I'll discuss the lockout and review the owners from around the league. You ready? Let's go.
Let's play ball.
All right. Well, thanks, Jalen. That was very enthusiastic. Let's start by dealing with the owner-implemented strike. The MLB and the MLBPA is still in a lockout. They have until February 28th to figure out an agreement in order to start the season on time, which is scheduled for March 31st. The two sides met on Monday in Jupiter, Florida, which seems very far away from me right now because it's so cold and snowy outside. I hate the cold. They worked separately, just going over their proposals, tweaking very little in order to reach a compromise. It's like a race between a snail and a slug right now. They worked to work out some key issues over minimum wage salary, which now stands at $570,000. The players' union is trying to make that go up to about $750,000, comparable to the NHL. That's where the minimum wage stands at there. Their proposal is $1 million. The luxury taxes on payroll, which hasn't been discussed yet at all, and raising the bonus pool for pre-arbitration players from $15 to $20 million. The players' union, they want it dispersed between the top 150 players, while the MLB is only wanting to allocate $15 million towards the top 30. So they're going to have to work that out. And, you know, the players' union wants to take care of all their young players, even the jobs in the minor leagues. So there's a discussion about all the number of jobs and the salaries within the minor leagues. Plus, there's a disagreement between the two about the lottery approach. The players' union wants 8 picks in the lottery, and the MLB wants only 4. They did say 3, but then they moved it up to 4. I kind of like the idea. It deters other teams from tanking, those bad teams, and it's like a race to see if we can get the first pick at that point. Finally, the owners want to expand the playoffs, but only if we can get a 162-game season in. So that's one of those things. If this doesn't get done, well, then there won't be an expansion of playoffs, of course. So that's more and more issues that's holding them back on figuring out a compromise in all this to get the season going. I mean, the MLB, they could start it right now with the old collective bargaining agreement that they had, but they're not doing that. They're not going to want to do that. I'm the boss.
I'm the boss.
I'm the boss.
I'm the boss.
Yeah, it just seems like everybody wanted to be a boss on both sides of the story. You know, you got the players' union, you got all the owners, but where is Rob Manfred, the commissioner? You know, he's supposed to be mandating this and mediating it and whatever other M word I can think of. Anyways, that's not going to stop us from having some fun here on the Royal Way now, is it, huh? Nope. They can wait 43 days to present their case after they declare a lockout. Whatever. But, you know, you make really good money as an owner. You really do. I could show you some facts, and that's what I'm about to do right now. You could see that, well, except for the Miami Marlins. You'll see later, but yeah. One of the greatest investments in all of all time, I mean, in sports history, definitely, is the New York Yankees. I hate to say that. I don't even like the Yankees, but man, look at these numbers. Check it out. Hal Steinbrenner inherited the team from his father, George Steinbrenner, who died in 2010. John Henry started trading corn and soybean futures in his early 20s. For Tampa Bay, they have Stuart Steinberg. He's a Wall Street guy. He's been with Goldman Sachs and trading stocks and stuff. Rogers is chairman of Rogers Communications, Inc. and Rogers Bank. He is director of Maple Leaf Sports and Entertainment. Helped launch the BlackBerry. Peter Angelos is one of Maryland's most prominent attorneys. He's won billions of dollars in judgments against tobacco and asbestos exposure lawsuits. John Sherman is the founder and CEO of Energy LP and Energy Mainstream. He's one of America's largest energy companies. The Dolan family were cable television pioneers who launched Cablevision in Long Island in 1973. Jerry Reinsdorf developed a specialty in real estate partnership tax shelters in 1973 and formed Balfour Company. He also owns the Chicago Bulls. Jim Pola took over as the team's chief executive after his father had passed away in 2009. Mike and Marion Illich founded the Little Caesars pizza chain in 1959. The family also owns the Detroit Red Wings of the NHL. Jim Crane owns Crane Capital Group, an investment management company. Stanton, 64, served as the head of several wireless companies in the 1980s. He is a telecommunications guru. Davis, 78, founded the Energy Transfer, a pipeline company and natural gas distributor. He worked on the Dakota Access Pipeline in 2017. Art Moreno made his early money through billboard advertising. He was also the minority owner of the Arizona Diamondbacks before purchasing the Angels. Fisher, 59, is the son of Donald and Doris Fisher, who founded the retail clothing giant Gap Inc. in 1969. Malone, 79, served as president and CEO of cable and media giant Telecommunications and chairman of Liberty Media Group. In 1856, Middleton's great-great-grandfather founded the small retail tobacco operation called Black and Mild, sold to Philip Morris. Stephen Cohen is the founder of hedge fund .72 Asset Management Group. Sherman, 72, co-founded the wealth management firm Private Capital Management in 1985. This guy, he owns the Washington Capitals, the Washington Mystics, the Washington Wizards, and Capital One Arena, all from a $250 loan from his wife. William DeWitt is founder of the investment firm Reynolds, DeWitt & Company, which owns 63 Arby's franchises and the U.S. Playing Card Company. Castellini inherited his family's fruit and vegetable wholesale company that was founded by his grandfather. Ricketts, 57, is the son of Joe Ricketts, an early online stock trading pioneer who founded Ameritrade. Nutting, 58, is the president and CEO of Ogden Newspapers, a publisher of more than 40 newspapers and media outlets. In 1991, Atancio, 62, co-founded the Los Angeles investment firm Crescent Capital Group. Johnson, 87, was only 24 when he became CEO of Franklin Templeton Investments. Walter, 60, is the CEO of Guggenheim Partners, a global financial services firm. Big money. Fowler, 76, bought out a brewing company he worked for and eventually distributes Miller, Coors, Heineken, and other beer brands. Monfort, 66, is the son of Kenneth Monfort, who owned a meatpacking and distributing company that was sold to ConAgra Foods in 1987. Kendrick, 77, founded Datatel Inc., a company that specializes in information processing and software products for higher education. Well, thank you, Layla, Riley, and Jalen. And now, it is trivia time! How did the KC Royals get their name, and why? And now, the top Royals prospects. All right, number one, Bobby Witt Jr., selected second in the 2019 draft out of Coffeyville, Texas. Bobby Witt Jr., son of 16-year pitcher Bobby Witt, his son is looking to take the big leagues by storm. Witt Jr. hit 33 home runs last year for the Omaha Storm Chasers, added 290, 97 RBIs, and 29 stolen bases. You will be hearing his name a lot this year. He was signed to a Royals record bonus of $7.8 million. Selected fourth overall in 2020, Asa Lacy, signed with the Royals on June 23rd for $6.67 million. Coming out of Texas A&M, there's some good things to come with this young 22-year-old. This left-handed first baseman was one of the top prospects in the 2017 draft. The 14th overall pick is ready to make an impact in the big leagues now. Number 3, Nick Prado. And finally, MJ Melendez. He was drafted by KC in 2017 in the second round, 52nd overall. He's a switch-hitting catcher who really turned it on lately in the minors. He could be next after Salvi. Well, it might be up to Cam Gallagher. Here's some honorable mentions here. More Royals prospects include Jackson Kowar, Jason Guzman, Alec Marsh, Nick Lofton, Jonathan Bolin, Eric Pena, and Vinny somebody else. They disappeared. Ah, well, let's just go to commercial. When we get back, I will go over the top 5 Royals pitchers. You want to see our starting rotation? Let's go right after these commercials.
I'm Kevin Britton, host of The 12th Man at Arrowhead Drive. Be sure to tune in every Sunday and Wednesday as I bring you all your Chiefs content. I'll be bringing you news, analysis, offering my opinion, player breakdown, roster evaluation, and everything you need regarding your Kansas City Chiefs. Again, that's The 12th Man at Arrowhead Drive every Sunday and Wednesday right here on Stadium Drive Sports.
Ooh, do you like elephants? If so, you're going to love the Royal Way. We use them to promote our show. Ooh, look, a little one. There are so many reasons to...
Watch the
Royal... One more time, let's say it. Right
through
him.
Watch the Royal Away. Watch the Royal Away.
Louder.
Watch the Royal Away.
Welcome back, Royals Empire. It is now time to go over the Royals starting pitching rotation. This is a public service announcement. Any rebroadcast, retransmission, or account of this game without the express written consent of Major League Baseball is prohibited. This is a strike, people. No baseball, okay? We here at MLB are working diligently to make this process go as slow as possible. We will figure it out. Until then, you see this baseball, it's going, gone. Thank you. Well, that sucks. I better figure something out by Monday.